All right, after now having all the theory of LFSRs, we understand fully how to explain those LFSRs, but that's no good if we don't actually make any use of them. Now, so far I've been mostly giving you warnings about how not to use LFSRs by saying, well, watch out, these are linear. If you give somebody two n-1 output bits, they can recover the whole state matrix, or they can recover all the coefficients and therefore compute everything. Well, maybe you don't give away keystream bits, but it sounds scary. Now, these things actually get used, and in particular in the area of hardware designs, where people want to have a small, cheap designs, it's very tempting to use these small registers with as few tabs as possible, because each of them costs you a wire, and then to do some things. So 851, when cell phones were young, there was the 2G network, and nowadays you might notice 2G as a terrible thing that you get when you're somewhere in the countryside or your data plan runs out. So 2G had some data privacy, has, well, voice encryption, and 851 is the algorithm that was used for that. And 851 is just a sum of three LFSRs drawn here on the picture. So these three LFSRs have primitive characteristic polynomials. That means they are, all of them have the maximum period you can get. So one has degree 23, degree 22, degree 19, and, well, obviously these are coprime because the degrees are different. And so we could see how large the degree is by multiplying, well, the LSM is just the product of these polynomials, but then it will be linear. Now it's maybe a little bit hard to see on the screen, but there are some of these positions which are marked in blue. So let me highlight those. Those three positions are used for clocking them. So clocking means you're advancing the LFSR by one position. So far we've always assumed that the LFSR advances per step, it produces one output bit, and it computes a new feedback bit. Now in this design, there are these three clock control bits that are marked in blue there. So that's the S12 position, the T11, and the V10 position. And the conditions for one of the registers to move is as follows. So you take those three bits, you compute the majority bit. Well, if all of them are zero, or if two of them are zero, one is one, then you have the majority zero, and else the majority is one. And then you advance the first one if S12 agrees with the majority, the second one if T11 agrees with the majority, and the third one if V10 is agreeing with the majority. Well, majority means there's at least two of this, so at least two of these registers advance, and sometimes also the third one advance. And that means they're not all moving at the same time, so it's not every clock cycle one shift, but there is some delay on one of those. And that means there is a nonlinearity in this function. These LFSRs have together 64 states, 64 register positions, and that's also how long the key is. However, bad old designs always disappoint you, so it's not actually meant for 2^64 security. 10 of those bits were known to be zero. So this is something we see a lot in the designs from the 90s or even the 80s and early 2000s, to be honest, that there were still a lot of concerns about letting people have cryptography. So that was the time of the export wars, of the crypto wars, which were all about export restrictions. To give you an idea of how 851 is working, so there is something called a frame number, so that is specific to mobile communication. You're talking to the cell tower or you talk to the other party, and then there's a 22-bit frame number that is basically the function that we used as the IV. So that gets fed in pretty much the same way that I explained to you, but in this case the LFSR, those are fixed, those are actually hardwired. There's a hardware which somewhere is built which has exactly those positions glued in. So when I was saying that the key bits could be defining the property of which CIs are non-zero, well, I was kind of fooling you there. This is not how it works, at least not in this case. And it's also a lot cheaper if you can actually build the hardware and then find some other place for the keys. So the CIs are not secret. But now we have some competition between the IV, which I promised you would be the starting state, and the keys, which, well, we don't actually have any place. So here's how IE5 is doing it. What they're doing is they run a key setup phase, which, well, uses key K, that was the 64 bits, some of which are zero, and then this frame number 22 bits, which is basically IV. So they're starting by putting all three registers, putting zeros into everything. And then in this key setup phase, when it says clock, that means all three of them advance. So all of them move one to the right each step. So there's not the condition on these clocking bits, that is only once you're producing key stream. So we're taking as the extra input, so you have this output part and you have the feedback part. And with the feedback, we're also feeding in the key, at least in the second phase of this key setup, and in the third phase, we're feeding in the initialization vector there. So at the beginning, everything is zero, and we are very slowly percolating in the key. So now the first key bit is in this 22nd, then the 21st, 23rd. So only after 23 steps will be an interesting moment where a feedback bit will be added to a key bit. But okay, there are 63 bits in the key, and so this will happen a few times around. And the other registers are shorter, so they're 22 and 19 stages. So for those, this will be happening, well, at least two times, and for the last one, three times. And then we're shifting over to feeding in the initialization vector. So the first part, the key is only known to Alice and Bob, the two communicating parties. And the third one, the IV, that is known to somebody who's sniffing the network. So anybody who is listening in, they get to see what the initialization vector is. And so that's why it's kind of important that that comes in when the register states are not known. So those get in added, and we don't actually know, I mean, the attacker doesn't know what the states are at that moment. And then just in case there's anything funky where the key or the initialization vector is still sticking around, the definition of A51 says, now run for 100 cycles and don't do anything with the output. And so at this point, we're now doing the normal clocking, so it depends on the majority bit, we're looking at those three positions, and we're advancing the registers only if their clocking bit matches the majority. And then we actually produce output key stream, and the definition of, well, for GSM, they need 114 bits for the definition of A to B, and 140 bits for B to A. So they're running for 228 cycles. Each cycle produces one output bit, and that is actually the real output that's going to get used. Now, nowadays, A51 is textbook material, I can explain this to you, but the design was actually kept secret. So this is a design from the 80s, which then in 1994, Ross Anderson in the UK was partially revealing. So he was saying that there was a guy who was supposed to give a talk, but he has received a notice from GCHQ, so the British equivalent of the NSA, that he may not speak. And so as he serviced the public, Ross Anderson then said, well, here's what I understand the design to be. And so he posted this. And then the full details were reverse engineered by Mark Guiceno, Ian Goldberg and David Wagner. So they understood what it is, then also did some analysis and got the attack further down. And they posted, most importantly, readable implementation. So the original link does no longer work, but you can actually get the full readable implementation from the link on the slides here, so that points you to Cryptome, and it is actually readable. I mean, I was in preparing for this course, I was reading through it, and they have one implementation which is, wow, takes you some time to read through, but it has good level of comments. Only difference is that they reverse the enumeration, so where I have the last bit, they have the first bit. But I was staying consistent with the other LFSRs I've been drawing, so here we go. The other thing they have in their post is, should I say, the little brother or the big brother, so there is an A52. And when you look at the design, oh, sorry, if you actually attack it, then it's far, far less than the 2 to the 54. So the latest attack costs already went written, which, you know, Goldberg and Wagner were doing it, they got it significantly below 2 to the 40, And then nowadays you can get down to 224 if you only have 3 to 4 minutes of ciphertext. So that is not assumed that you have keystream output, but you have ciphertext. So it's a real attack. It's a real attack valid in the GSM scenario. And if you have less ciphertext, so just a few frames, then you need more computer power, but it can be attacked in that case as well. I was already going one step further and saying that there is, in the same implementation, there's another cipher. And when you look at this, this actually needs a lot more space and needs a lot more thinking to understand what's actually going on. So A52 is not only having this three LFSRs, but there's a fourth LFSR. I don't expect you to see this immediately, but the first three LFSRs are the same as on the previous page. Now there are no longer any blue pieces, so the clocking is handled differently, and this last LFSR is there to clock these registers. So the bottom LFSR is x to the 17, x plus x to the 5 plus 1 as a character polynomial, so it's another primitive LFSR, and it doesn't add anything to the output, so it just runs, but it draws 3 bits and puts them in what I call the clock there. And then this clock does again a majority vote, and it advances the registers. Well, the first one goes to the top one, to the next one, to the next one, so it only advances the ones where the bit matches the majority. And then the bottom one always advances by one per step. Then there is more feeding into the input as well. So let's take a look at this. So here, here, and here, we're getting more bits feeding into the sum here. So first of all, it's just the normal LFSRs feeding into it, but in addition, the cipher grabs this bit and then adds one to it. So if it was zero, it becomes one. If it was one, it becomes zero. So this is flipping the bit. It's doing a not on the bit. And then takes this one, and it does a majority vote of those three. And then whatever the majority gets fed into the sum. And same here, and same here. And each time, one of those threes comes in with a plus one. Okay, so more details of this. So first of all, this looks a lot more complicated, but this is actually the version that the GSM Consortium designed for export control. So this is what they ship to countries outside, say, Europe, America, well, the Five Eyes countries were also the friendly ones. But for other countries, they said, no, you're not allowed to have the strong crypto, you're not allowed to have those 2 to the 55 strength. Well, it wasn't quite that much, but that many qubits they claim to have. This one has fewer qubits, and this design has some extra properties. Now, the key and the frame number are used very similarly to how they're used in A51. Now, in this case, they also start filling in R4, so the initialization will be also 0, the R4, and then start feeding in the key pieces and the frame number pieces. The clock controller explained already, and it is surprising how much effort somebody put into the design to make it a lot more convoluted and still be weaker. Now, in 1999, the same team that I already credited on the previous slide, they gave a talk at the Crypto RUM session showing the full break of the system, where full break was assuming they have keystream output, but they showed that this convoluted design is a lot less secure than the A51. Now, bad things are that when you have a design which is export control and a design which is not export control, cell phones have to support both of those. And that meant that for a long time it was possible to do a downgrade attack from A52, from A51 to A52. So both of them were present, and you, as an attacker, you could interfere with the connection to the cell tower and convince both sides that the other party was, well, export control restricted, so they could only talk A52 with you. And then A52 is now broken instantly. So 2 to the 16 steps. In a 2018 paper, they showed that it really is breakable in a snap. Snowden documents showed that the NSA can listen in into the A5 communications, so both for A51 as well as for A52. There were no real details, so we don't know whether it was the downgrade attack or whether they assume that the A51, the 2^24 computations are also easily doable. I mean, it's certainly something they can do on the computer cluster. And this has gotten enough public attention, so there's now a table of pre-computations, so you can actually do this instant attack, except for, luckily, there's now a motion that cell towers should no longer accept connections that are using A52. But they did for a long, long time. I mean, broken in 99 and then 2008, it was still a possible attack to do something. So showing that those things are really bad, that is not enough to get the physical world to move. You have to show that it's actually working on ciphertext only and is practical. Now here's an example of a good cipher, or at least not a known to be broken cipher, namely the Snow 3G. So this is another from the 3G consortium. So again, about telecommunications, after 2G came 3G, which you might encounter a little more frequently these days. And that is, again, Elvis R-based design. It's a lot less convoluted until you realize that each of those pieces, the S0 to S15, are not single bits, but each of those is 32 bits. So it's an actual full word. And now, in this case, I was lazy and I was just taking the picture from one of the online sources. So this time the output goes to the right rather than to the left. Sorry for that. I didn't take the time to transpose it. Now what you see here is that the tabs, so the coefficients are again just very few, so it's a cheap design. When there's a plus, it means addition in F2^32, so in this fine field. And this alpha, which appears both on the S0 coefficient and on the S11 coefficient, those are fixed field elements. So there's some coefficient alpha and its inverse, which get multiplied there. And when we introduced LFSRs, we had them in the most general settings. So there was, we first did general feedback shift registers, then we did linear feedback shift registers, where we have these coefficients that we multiply by, and then we specialized to look only at F2. Now here's an example from the real world, which is using larger fields. But you could analyze the top part with the tools that we have. You need to check all the generalizations, but it works the same. But then it would be linear. So the bottom part is actually very important. So this FSM stands for finite state machine, and this bottom part is doing nonlinear operations. It forgets everything that has to do with the field operation, and it takes just these 32 bits and it draws from here and draws from here. And then when you see a plus and a square, then that means you're looking at those 32 bits as an integer between 0 and 2^32, strictly less than 2^32, and you're doing addition modulo 2^32. So that is integer addition, which means you're having carries. If you're adding 1 plus 1 in that scenario, you're not getting 0, as with the plus and a circle, but you're getting 2. So the square thing does carries, and carries are inherently nonlinear. Also, there's more happening. So these RI here, those are just registers. So these are three more registers of 32 bits each. And then each clock cycle, these advance to the next step. And from getting from R1 to R2, it runs through a function S1. And this function S1 is a substitution function which takes 32 bits and basically does a table lookup. So it takes 32 bits and gives you a different 32 bits back. These boxes, these substitution boxes, are composed of smaller values. So if you want to look into the specification, you can actually find all the details. For us, it's sufficient to see, yes, LFSRs are still used in practice with some nonlinear components, and you can find out more when you go to the sources that are linked from there, or actually linked from the next page. So to wrap things up, so LFSRs are typical ingredients of hardware ciphers, in particular when you're looking at lightweight designs into something which is, cell phones in the early days were really drawn battery for everything, so they didn't want to use much better for the cryptography, but also if you have, say, the car keys, or if you have a garage door opener, if you have a satellite phone. All of those were using cryptography designed with hardware ciphers. Elvis asks, do you need a nonlinear component? That I was stressing already before, so do not use a pure LFSR just because you understand everything about it. It's better to not fully understand everything than to have something which is understood but totally weak. In the attack models, even though you might not in the real world give somebody access to keystreams, in the attack models we always assume that the attacker has access to the keystream. So in that model, an LFSR is instantly broken. Of course, for practical relevance, the keystream or ciphertext only attacks are more relevant, so keystream attacks are less relevant, but it's definitely a warning sign that you shouldn't use one of those. Many of the old designs had a lot of the security by obscurity, and once somebody had reverse engineered or some design documents appeared magically, then the security degraded. So I'm copying here table 3 from the paper I'm linking above there, and you see the A51, A52 that we just looked at. They actually have space, 64 bits for the key. There's this frame number, which is playing the role of the initialization vector, and the attack time has gone down to 2 to the 24 and 2 to the 16. And when you look at this page, well, look at this paper, and look at this table 3, it's basically just a massacre of legacy ciphers. Everything, whether it was designed for 64, for 80 bits, everything has gone down to 2 to the 40, which is practically usable, practically breakable. And there are huge discrepancies between the design strengths and the actual strength. But the good news is most of that paper is actually about secure or state-of-the-art lightweight symmetric systems, not all of which are broken. So there's lots of other designs which are, for nowadays, for the usability, more relevant. But of course, if you want to look at understanding whether those designs are secure, we need to understand how the old ones got broken. And so that's why we're focusing a lot on the legacy designs, because for those, the attacks are well understood. And we've now basically wrapped up the chapter about LFSRs, so we understand how to analyze, not cryptanalyze, but really just understand how long the periods are. If I show you an LFSR, you know with very few computational steps, basically just the factorization of polynomials, how to figure out what the periods of this LFSR are depending on what the input state is. And we understand how to add some nonlinearity, or also how not to add some nonlinearity. All right, that's the end of LFSRs, but it's not yet the end of stream ciphers, so stay tuned for more.